Hi everyone. Welcome to AI Talk hosted by E2E Networks. My name is Aarti Sharma and I take care of business development for Maharashtra region. So basically the purpose of hosting webinar is to build an AI community where the members can benefit from the industry experts. And today we have Mr. Singhal, who is a founding partner of Pi Ventures. And he will be talking about building AI startups and building AI mindset, under which he will be talking about framework to understand AI products or startups, how to go about building an AI product, key consideration around data and related techniques. And most important, for a Q&A part, if you have any query, you can mention your query in Q&A section, which you will be getting in your screen. And at the end of the webinar, Mr. Manish will answer all your queries. As well, at the end, I'll be disclosing our next speaker and the topic. Thank you so much, Mr. Manish. Now you can take it ahead from here. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Aarti. Yeah. For the opportunity. You will have to make, thank you so much. So let me do this. Okay. So, you know, there is an issue here that I'm sharing my screen, but if there are questions that come up on the thing, then I won't be able to find out. How do we do this? Okay. Aarti, I'll need your help here because I'm using the same computer and from which I need to share my presentation. If somebody types a question, I won't get to know. So you just prompt me and I will check it out. Okay.
Yeah, so you can also answer all these answer at the end of your presentation, actually.
Yeah, that may not work with the kind of presentation I have. I don't have a separate Q&A session. I can do that. But I think, so for everyone who's on the call, thanks for joining, first of all. What we will do is we will sort of explore some topics in AI and sort of break it down. I have some very basic slides. I don't have too many slides. The idea is to invoke a thinking and give you some sort of a construct on how to go about building AI in your products or building AI products. And what I would like to do is to make it interactive. So if you have a question, just post it in the Q&A in live as we go along. And I'll be able to answer them as we go along. So we want to keep it interactive. And then go from there. Okay.
Okay, Manish, you share the PPT. I'll present from here.
Okay, you want to do that way. Fine, I think we can do that way as well. So then I will be able to see the questions as well. That's a good idea. So just folks, sorry about this delay. Just give me a second here. Yes, Aarti, I have shared the presentation with you. So if you can just put it up, then it will be easier. I think that's a good idea and I can see the Q&A in running.
Okay. Just give me a moment.
Sure.
Okay.
Pradeep, you have a hand raised. If you have a question, please put it in the Q&A session. Pradeep, yeah, thanks. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, just go.
Okay, just put it on full screen, Aarti. Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much, Aarti. So let's get started. Sorry for the delay again, folks. And as I said, if you would like to take runtime questions, so anytime you have a question, just put it in the Q&A session and I'll take it and take them as we go along. So Aarti, next slide, please. So I think first of all, there is so much of talk and hype around AI, and everybody has sort of a different perception about what AI is and how to distinguish between AI and non-AI. So I have just first section of the talk is just about what is AI, right? So I think the best way to describe what is AI is, Aarti, next slide, is technologies that mimic human perception. So as you know that, human beings, our way of learning is pattern-based. So just to give you a very simple example, if you take a kid, a young kid of 3-4 years, show him or her pictures of around 10-15 cats, then it's quite likely that the kid will be able to recognize another picture, which is not one of the earlier pictures shown, but is of a different cat. There is a very high probability that kid will be able to recognize it's a cat or not. So if you break this down in the head of the person or the kid is not going like in a mechanism which is like it has four legs, it has tails, it has whiskers, and therefore it's a cat. But looking at all these 15 pictures, the kid has formed some sort of a pattern around what a cat looks like, and that is what they are able to apply to the new input to determine whether it's a cat or not, right? So Aarti, next slide. So essentially AI technologies work on pattern based rather than a conventional system which works on rule based. And pattern based is how humans also learn, and that has a different paradigm. So I'll just explain this a little bit more. Next slide. So in a classical programming, right, so you sort of have data, you have rules that you define in the form of if, then, else, and whatnot, all the cases that you typically define, and you get answers, right? So that's the classical programming. Next slide. Whereas in AI, what we say is that if I have enough data and if I have enough answers to feed into an engine, then it can possibly come up with its own rules. So when we have that kind of a construct, then we are in the AI paradigm versus the classical paradigm. Let me just take a moment here and see if there are any questions first on the basic concept of AI. Okay, and you can ask as we go along. So let's So I think the bigger question here is, so what is the big deal, right? So if I can do patent-based versus rule-based, Aarthi, next slide. What is the big deal, right? So next slide. So I think what happens is any natural system, in any practical system, suppose you're designing a Google Maps or you're designing Alexa how to talk back to you, or you are designing credit scoring system, or you're designing, let's say, customer identification system or whatever else, there are a lot of cases, there are quite a few cases which are clear A0 and 1, right? So this is an A and this is an B. But in real life scenarios, there are a lot of cases which fall in the gray area. So you're not able to determine whether it's a cat or a dog or whatever else, right, in some parlance. So when you have an AI system, it will be able to make better decisions in the gray area rather than a rule-based system, because rule-based system is by definition limited by the rules it has or the rules you have defined. It's limited by that. And you cannot possibly come up with all the possible rules to define that system. So to take a very simple example, suppose you were designing Alexa. Alexa is, it's able to converse with you. You can talk to it and it talks back. Now, suppose you were designing a rule-based system, it will become extremely complex, right? You will have to put, if it says hi, then, and it says then this, then do this, then this. And it's going to become an impossible system. Whereas in an AI system, if I feed it with good enough data and build a model, then it will be able to learn and respond to those much more easily. So that's the sort of a difference, why AI is becoming mainstream, because it gives better decisions in gray areas, which is a typical system. A typical system has that. And that becomes, in commercial applications, it becomes much more useful. Okay. So proceeding from here, let's talk about a concept, Aarthi, next slide, of why AI. So I think this is one area where I've seen quite a few entrepreneurs as well as engineers going a little bit here and there. So I think AI, as much as it is a craze and hype, it is also a very useful tool. But remember that it's a tool. So I think the first step towards building an AI product or an AI application is to answer the question, why do you want to use AI? And the reasons could be many, but you have to really nail it down. So for example, if it is credit scoring system, then you need to figure out why you need AI versus a rule-based system. Why would this do better than this? And if suppose I'm doing a routing algorithm, then you have to answer the question of why AI, or what would AI serve in your system? So, and this can take some time. This is typically an iterative process for startups also to discover why should they use AI and why not something else. So once you go past this hurdle, then only you should proceed. But I think the first fundamental step towards building any AI system is to have clarity of why that system needs to have AI, right? And let's go forward, and I'll explain you the concept of RP. Next slide is AI first and AI second. I think this is a very important concept, and it goes back and links with the why AI thing. So what we do is, this is not a standard terminology. This is more of an internal terminology we use at PI. There are certain companies which we call as AI first, and there are certain companies we call AI second. And what is the difference? AI first companies are companies or problems which can only be solved by AI. It is very difficult or impossible to solve them using a rule-based system. Whereas AI second are problems which you could solve in a simple way, but using an AI layer, it gives you better results. So just to give you a couple of examples, Alexa, for example, is an AI first system. It is very difficult to implement Alexa kind of system by a rule-based mechanism. You talk to it, it talks back to you. It's an AI first, right? Self-driving car is an AI first system. Without that, it becomes extremely difficult to build those. AI second, however, is something like Google Maps. So if I take out the traffic data and its dynamic routing, etc., then it is still useful because it shows me how to get from point A to point B. But if I incorporate AI, then it in real time, it can show me dynamic routing that, okay, take this route versus this route. etc., for my use, right? So this is a fundamental difference between AI first and AI second. And as you answer your why AI question, it is good to always have good clarity that are you solving an AI first problem or an AI second problem? Because it changes the way you build your startup. So for example, if you are solving an AI first problem, then it is, you have to figure the entire data out first. You have to figure out the entire model first before you are useful to anybody. But if it is a AI second problem, then you can get off the blocks by solving the first fundamental need of a customer, and maybe you can build AI on top of the data getting generated by built by that serving that need, right? So it changes the path, it changes your GTM, it changes your product architecture. It has several implications on how to build these startups. And therefore, it is important to know first up whether you are in the AI first category or in the AI second category. Can you give, so there is a question here, can you give some examples for AI first and second problems? Absolutely. So I just did, but let me give you some more examples of the companies that are in our portfolio. So we have a company called Niramay, which does breast cancer screening. So what they do is they take a thermal picture, and then using AI on the thermal pictures, they are able to determine whether there is cancer or not. This is fundamentally an AI first problem. The reason being is that those thermal scans are so complicated, they cannot be read by human eye, and it is very difficult to make a rule-based program for that. So it's an AI first problem. Only with AI you can solve it. Similarly, we have another company called SigTuple, which has done blood analysis, urine analysis, semen analysis using AI machine. So they take the slides of these samples, they take pictures of those samples, and then using an AI computer vision algorithm to determine what the issue is. And that is also fundamentally an AI first problem. An AI second problem, example could be another company from our cohort is Locus. They are a routing company, so they figure out all the, like for example, they power the entire big basket operations on the back in logistics planning, but they can use a whole bunch of things without AI to do that. But with AI, they do better job. So they are able to locate the lat long very accurately. They are able to dynamically route it, etc., to increase the efficiency. So these are some examples. I'm happy to give more if that doesn't answer. There is a next question which says, what is your view on using AI and voice for Bharatiya Bhashas, Indic languages? Yeah, absolutely. I think if you were to, and in fact, there was a company here called Lib.ai, which got acquired by Flipkart. That was an Indic language company which was using AI to converse with you in several Indic languages. So any language understanding startup, which could be about NLU, which is natural language understanding, or NLG, which is natural language generation, in any English, Hindi, whatever, typically these are AI first systems, and it is very difficult to build them otherwise. So to answer your question, yes, I think there is a big use case of using AI for Indic languages. Any other questions? How to start with learning AI? Okay, attend this webinar, I think. No, so I think there is a lot of material on the web which you can find today about AI. So that's one way of getting started with AI. There is also a fantastic course which I have personally done. It's by a guy called Andrew Ng on Coursera about AI. So that you could use that bunch of things. Best thing is start working on some little problems with data sets that are available. It will give you more exposure. There is plenty out there to learn AI from. Especially Alexa is for me. Yeah, so Alexa, it's the same thing, right? So I think once you have the engine built, then you can deploy with, you work with Amazon team to deploy it. It should be possible. I don't know the Alexa workflow, but I think it's about building the core engine first, and then you can deploy it using Alexa. But I could be wrong there, because I have not seen Indic languages skills on Alexa yet, although I have seen a lot of other skills which work in English language. So there is a way to integrate it, but I think it's worth exploring. What is system requirement for AI development and deployment? I think it totally depends upon your, so thanks for answering that. Hindi is there on Alexa, then you can build it. So what is the system requirement for AI? It totally depends upon the problem you are solving. AI systems also is a wide spectrum. You could have a very simple classifier to very complicated deep learning network, typically requiring GPUs to do. So I think the simplest thing for you, if you are just starting off to learn AI, is to go to one of the Amazon's and Microsoft clouds. They have some AI hosted servers which you can help you get started with. Okay. So I hope this concept of AI first and AI second is clear. Let me proceed from here, and then I can keep answering questions in parallel. Aarti, next slide. So I think once you have understood why you want to build an AI system, what business requirement it is solving, once you have figured out whether you are AI first or an AI second problem, then comes the problem of understanding where the data will come from. As you know, all AI systems need a lot of data to learn from. So understanding data is as critical as understanding the first two questions that we just talked about. Aarti, next slide. So how do you understand data? These are some questions that you can think about. First of all, are these data sets easily available? Can I, if I am developing something, are they easily available on the web? Somebody else can also get access to it. How much of it is publicly available data? How much it is private? How much do you need to generate? What does it take to generate data? Like recently we met with a couple of startups, and they are working with a certain form of DNA sequencing for certain application. So for them, because that data does not exist ever, they will have to go and generate for every sample before they can do something, right? So the cost of generating data sometimes becomes an important element to think about while building your AI startup. Can others get access to the same data? If so, then you may not have a differentiation in the market, right? So because unless you have designed a very smart algorithm. So sometimes while figuring out how you will get data, it is also good to figure out what is the unique access you have to the data, which can help you build a moat around yourself while you are building startup, right? In AI second startups, even in AI first, I think it is also an important consideration to give when you deploy the system, do you get runtime data, which then you can use to train? So sometimes the customer, agreements, vendor agreements, etc., consumer agreements have to have that ability so that you can use that data for further training. In an AI second system, sometimes when you're doing stuff, then the byproduct of that gives you enough data to train systems, right? So for example, as I gave you a locus example, once they were delivering a lot of stuff, they got all those lat long data generated from the system, which helped them tune the model, their model, and they didn't have to spend anything because it was a byproduct of a thing they were already doing. And the last, not the least, is this is a growing problem. Is your model data hungry or data optimal? And I'll talk about it a little bit more in the next slide as well. But essentially, does your model need lots and lots of data to train? Or have you done some optimizations in your algorithm or the way you do it so that your model does not need that much data? So obviously, there are pros and cons of it. Some problems are very difficult to solve unless you have that kind of data. But in a lot of problems, you can come up with a very good solution even with small sets of data by doing smart algorithms. And those things are going to become very, very important in the future. Next slide, please. So this brings us to this concept of deep learning versus feature model engineering, which is often overlooked. So, a deep learning is a method where I have a neural network, I throw a lot of data to it, and it figures out its own features and rules and models, right? And that requires a lot of data, labeled data to get working. Sometimes it's very expensive, but some problems you can't do away without it. But there is a very effective model which is often ignored called feature model engineering. So So what happens is that you know how to, if you understand the problem well, then you can design a feature model based system yourself. Manually features can be designed and you train the weights on it. So for example, if you are trying to separate a bunch of circles from a bunch of squares in shapes, then one of the feature you could pick out is a right angle. And as long as I can find a right angle in the shape, then I can distinguish the two shapes, right? So this is an example of a feature. In a practical system, these numbers run into 50 to 100 features or even more. So you can manually design them and train the model. So in those cases, what happens is that your data requirement for those models is much lower than in a deep learning network. And other thing advantages that it gives is that it gives you explainability, it gives you debuggability, it gives you a lot more control over the problem that you are solving. So this is often overlooked, but it is a very, very smart way of building an AI startups. So as you go along, just to recap, the first step to building an AI startup is to think about why you want to use AI. Second step is to figure out whether you are an AI first or an AI second problem. Third step is to figure out what is the data constraints or pros and cons regarding the problem you are solving. And the fourth step is to choose a model between deep learning and feature model engineering. Once you go these four broad steps, I think it gives you a very good grounding to get started with how to design an AI model. I think those are the only slides I had. I just wanted to keep it brief and keep it high level so that we can, there is a basic construct that I'm able to communicate to all of you in how to go about doing it. And now I think I'm open to all kind of questions. Please do ask. Yeah. All right, resources for AI on text. There are a bunch of resources, I don't know offhand, but just Google and you'll find, and there are whole kind of things available from Stanford, from other stations. What is the role of data science in AI? Data science is AI, I mean, so whatever we talked about is data science. So what when you categorize your data, you figure out all that is data science, and it is loosely sometimes called AI also. So AI is a whole artificial intelligence built on data science. So they are very much hand in hand. Okay, I have to scroll to see this. Can you explain featured model deep learning with a few examples, please? Of course. Okay, so this is it actually requires a board for me to sort of explain, but let me try and do without a board. So, okay, so I'll go back to the same example. I think that is simple enough to illustrate the example, right? So let's define the problem first. So let's say you have a bunch of shapes, circles and squares, right? And I want to make a system based on, and of course, the irony of this example is it is actually much more solvable, easily solvable by rules, rule-based system. But let us say we chose AI to do it, just to illustrate the example. So between distinguishing circles and squares, I know that there is one important feature which distinguishes a circle from a square, which is the presence of a right angle, right? So if I can build a feature design model which says, look for an angle and train it with the number of shapes. So I'm assuming that your shapes are not perfectly regular, they are a little bit irregular, so it needs a little bit of a training. So if I design a model with only one feature, that look for an angle, and then train the weight on it, whether the angle is, how much tolerance within 90 degrees that should be to determine you between the scale square and the circle. How would I do a deep learning network on this? I will create a neural net and I will give it lot of data. I will give it like, these are the 10 shapes which are circle. These are the 10 shapes which are square, right? In a labeled data set. And then it will learn and figure out a way itself that, okay, this is a feature I'm looking for. And then when you run the new data set, it will try to figure it out. This problem can be further explained, further enlarged. So let us say it is not just square and circles, but it is circle and any other triangle, pentagons, hexagon, etc., etc. So then this problems becomes complex. And then in the feature design model, I will say, look for edges and angles, and I will build a system around it, train the weights on it. Whereas in a deep learning network, I will give it enough data for each of these shapes to for it to learn how to distinguish, right? So that is the difference between, I hope it explains, what is the fundamental difference between the two approaches. BI, ML, AI equal to what? I have no idea about what this question is. Can you please, Sanjay, can you please ask this question again? How much AI is used now in venture investing process, essentially take investment? So we don't, right? So we don't yet use AI in figuring out our investments. I think this question is often asked to me, and I'm still on the edge on this one. Can we build models to break down the problem? So just to take this topic forward, right? One of the very important assessment for any venture investor in early stages is to figure out the founder, how good the founders are, right? And there is a lot which is talked about the various aspects of the founders. So one of the areas that AI could help is to determine certain skills that typically you see in successful entrepreneurs, and then see whether you could use that model to determine better for the founders, right? So similarly, you could use in other areas, but we are not using it right now. And I have not known for any of my peers across in the venture industry also who are using it. What pre-skills needed to learn AI? Actually, very little. You need to probably learn maybe Python, because Python is becoming a good language to start with AI. And obviously, you need to have some basic computer science understanding of data, etc. So that's all. And then it's easy to learn. Best online sources. I just said that there is a Coursera. I think I would suggest everybody doing a course. It's an Andrew Ng course on Coursera, on AI. It has very good examples. It has programming examples. It is something that I would encourage you to do it. How can AI make impact in education, as recommendation and prediction impact the career of a student, and how cautiously we should proceed? DL or PhD is good to start. It depends upon what problem are you solving, right? So if in education, there are several problems. If you are customizing content for someone, so let's say I learn differently from someone else, and if a teacher or a system can show me different content according to what I understand and what I not versus the other, then the impact of your recommendation going wrong is not so high, I would say, right? Because I would still go and learn something else. But let us say you are doing an assessment, which is hard, not manually. You're trying to assess my answers with respect to someone else for a certain outcome. Then that has to be a lot more accurate data, but it is highly subjective as well. So I would say, depending upon what problem you are solving, you should look at then how AI can impact negatively or positively. DL or feature model is not a criteria, doesn't come from the problem you are solving. It comes more from the data that you are solving and whether you understand how to solve the problem. So what I mean to say that is, suppose you have no idea what a square looks like, what a circle looks like. You have no idea whether there is a concept of right angle. Then you would need to use a deep learning network to figure this out, right? Because you will have to cluster them. But if you have a basic idea about the problem you are trying to solve, then feature model is good to understand and start. Any real life problems you have solved? I mean, all our companies are solving real life problems, if that is what the question is. We have 10 companies, all those, and you can look them up on our website. All those problems are being solved by AI, by our companies. Sir, currently I'm working on chatbot. Can you suggest how to use rule-based AI in chatbot? So yeah, I think rule-based AI will not work. There is nothing called rule-based AI, first of all. Either you have a rule-based system or an AI-based system. You obviously have certain decision matrix on top of it to understand, but chatbot is fundamentally a good chatbot is fundamentally an AI system. At what stage AI-based startup should look for an investor? I think any stage is fine. I keep saying this. There are investors for every stage. At seed stage, you will find different investors. At Series A, you will find different stage investors, etc. So there are investors at every stage. I think the more, I would say, a better thing to probably see is whether you as an entrepreneur are clear about the problem you are solving, whether you are convinced about how to solve that. If you are convinced, then it's a good time to start to talk to investors. But obviously, all investors love to see some proof point. So if you have just a PowerPoint, it may, the chances of getting funding is lower. So you may want to build some MVPs, try some things out, and be more clear about the problem that you are solving and how you will solve it. Then you will build more investor confidence. We are investing previous in business intelligence, then machine learning comes. We also started investing in it. Now artificial intelligence comes. So is it next technology comes? So we invest real end. Okay. So you're saying how these technologies have kind of evolved and what it is. I think artificial intelligence is here to stay for a long time. It is just we are seeing a beginning of it. And I do believe that in the future, all products will use AI in some form or the other. So AI is a long-term investment. I think you're good on it. There are certain applications which will see quantum computing and those kind of things. But in the digital part of it, I think AI is here to stay for a long time. With cloud service providers offering AI models as a service, would one rather leverage that versus... Yeah, absolutely. I think you should do that. So it again depends upon what problem you are solving and how deeply you are solving. If your problem can be solved by the cloud service providers who have their off-the-shelf models, please don't reinvent. Just go and use it. But what we have typically seen is that when companies start to develop solutions for a particular customer or a use case, it becomes deeper and deeper, and then some off-the-shelf models typically don't work, right? So eventually you will end up doing your own models, but to get started, you should use what is available. And you never know that you may, for example, there are certain parts in your system which are just off the shelf models, and there are certain parts which you have designed yourself. So totally depends upon the problem you're solving. Good API which reads from images. For example, we have cash depositing from in my bank. My requirement is to read data from image. I don't know whether there is a API out there, but there are startups solving this problem, because this also requires a little bit of verticalization. There is a company called Merak.ai, which is sort of solving this problem as well. So I think you may have to look at some of the startups doing this. As we know, AI has a lot of topics. So if I'm a beginner, so where we can... Again, I answered this question before. There is a whole lot of things out there on the web. Please read about it. Do the course on the Coursera from end to end, and you can get started this way. If traction is not generated, sales is always a hard problem more than MVP is done. How do investors see that and are willing to fund, as funding can solve a lot of problems in terms of reach outs, hiring, accelerating growth? If traction is not there, you mean, okay, sales is a hard problem more than MVP is done. How do investors? So I think, again, it depends upon the investors and it depends upon the problem you are solving. So let me give you an example. Suppose you come here and you build another chatbot, and there are like thousands of them outside. So then the differentiation between you and the other startups is very little. And in that case, you will have to show a greater traction on the market share. Then the question in the investor's mind will change that, okay, you are solving a problem which so many other startups are solving, but you could be a winner because you have lot more traction. But let's say you are solving next generation, you are trying to figure out from a thermal scan some sort of pancreatic cancer or whatever else, right? Some dumb deep problem. Then there are not so many startups addressing that, and it's a tough problem as well, right? So in that case, investor interest might be there if you are solving a very hard problem and you have a way to solve that problem, and investor can get confidence that you can solve it. So it really depends upon the problem you are solving. What a prospect to learn AI for a Java developer. Absolutely, I think there is no problem being a Java developer or whatever. I think learn data science, basic data science, learn Python. You can get started with AI. Is AI a necessity currently? If not, how long do you think it will take to reach the level of absolute necessity? I think it's not a question of necessity or not necessity. I think it's a question of, again, going back to the framework, I think we have to answer the question of why AI is needed for your business. If it is not needed, please don't do it. And all the other questions that we debated about. So, but one thing is there that let us say I'm doing a product and I'm not using AI effectively, but my competitors are, then there is a likelihood that my competitors' products may do better than my product, right? So I think there may come a point, and I don't know what that point is, maybe different for different sectors, where without AI, you may lose competitive edge in the market. So in a lot of sectors, maybe it is already there, right? So you have to really look at what problem you are solving and then see how competitive the scenario right now is. I want to develop generative chatbots using RNN, LSTM, and attention intention. Generative chatbots. Okay, so you want to do natural language generation using LSTMs. I think that's LSTM is typically used for chatbots because it has this short-term memory and in TensorFlow. How can I use this? I think I am not qualified enough to answer how you can use TensorFlow in it, but LSTM is the right method to go about doing it. Maybe you can Google and find this out. Okay. Okay, so we are done here, I think. Ready if it, yeah. So if there are no more questions, we can wind this up. If there are some more questions, happy to take them.
Yeah, I think let's wait for 1 minute. If someone has some question, they can come up. Otherwise, we'll wrap up.
Sure thing.
Yeah.
Sure thing. So again, I just want to say one thing, right? So just make sure that you are not getting into this and getting lost because everybody is using the AI and therefore I need to use it, etc. I think that probably is not a very effective way of looking at it. Answer the fundamental questions which I answered in the deck, and the deck will be sent by Aarti to all the participants and work through that. Just make sure that the use of AI is real in your product. The use of AI gives you a edge over your competitors. Use of AI solves a real problem for your customers. That will actually give you much more solid implementation of AI. Okay.
So,
I hope it was useful for all of you. Although it's a little bit of a weird thing for me to sort of, it almost sounded like a one-way communication with answering questions in the chat. Normally, interactive voice works better. But I hope it was useful for you. And we also do this chai sessions every month. Please join our meetup group. I think the next one is on 21st. Feel free to drop in and you can learn more about AI in those chai sessions as well.
Sure. So Manish, I think Anish has some question not related to AI. So if you are okay, you want to ask something.
Yeah, go ahead. Is that the question? What are the least penetrated markets recently, currently? Can you send the link for meetup chai session? I think just do Google. I don't remember the meetup link, but if you go to meetup, just Google meetup chai Pi Ventures, you will get it. If not, drop me a note on LinkedIn and I will send it to you. Least penetrated markets, sectors, I think what we are seeing is AI is pretty well, actually, Aarti, can you make me the presenter? I just want to show another slide from another deck.
Acha, sure. Wait.
See, I assume that this is the AI question, right? So actually we are seeing penetration of AI in across multiple sectors. You name it, marketing, sales, retail, hospitality, healthcare, of course, agri, fintech, video analytics, enterprise, conversational. And there are lots of companies. In the last 3 years, we have met around 1,000 companies. 60-70% of them have AI. In fact, on this slide, every company that is written here, logo, we have met them. These are not all the companies that have applied to us, right? These are all the companies that we have met. So it's a very rich, diverse system. I think people are trying to attack it from various angles. And, you know, it's, you know, I think it's pretty out there. How can AI help the news media sector? Absolutely. I think there is a, you know, you must be knowing Vikram Chandra, right? NDTV is a good friend of mine. He's actually launched a company called Editor G. You look it up. So they are using a lot of AI in filtering out the stories they show you. They're using AI in generating video clips automatically, etc. So AI is being used, and it will get used media and news industry as well. Chai meetup or chai? Yes, that's the one. Is it more theoretical question? Do you think AI is like an extension of statistics? That's a very good question, actually. So yes, it is in a lot of ways. So the whole fundamentals about the building block of AI is about patterns, right? So unless you have patterns, the AI is going to not do a good job, right? It's about clustering. It's a complicated clustering. So it is, I would say it is, it is an extension of AI, but it can, it is a very, very complicated extension of AI. It's a multi-dimensional stats in multiple this thing that you can visualize it as. But the fundamentals of AI comes from statistics.
I want to create a voice model which can recognize a voice and response in voice.
Yeah, absolutely. Google it up. It's an AI problem. You can do ASR and all that. You will be able to get some of the building blocks and then get going with it. Here is the URL. Oh, thanks. Thanks for sending this. I hope that's the right URL. Let me just check it out. Yes, so that's the correct URL. You can, some of you can register here and watch out for our next chai, which will happen on, it's not announced yet, but it will happen on September 21st. It's like a fuzzy logic. Yeah, fuzzy logic is a rudimentary form of AI.
I think it's more complicated than that, as I said, but yes. Yeah.
Can be used in the religious sector. Yeah, it can be, I think. Depends upon the problem you are trying to solve. If you're trying to say that, okay, can God help me with this and therefore AI can help me, then God help you. But in case that you are trying to figure out, you know, in these new religious startups we've met actually,
where, you know, without going to a temple, can I make a very immersive experience of being in Tirupati,
you know, so it's an AR, PR, AI problem. And I can be there and not being there, right? So those kind of problems are being solved in the religious sector. How can we use AI to break the news faster and make every voice heard? Wow. Well, I don't know. Make a startup and come to us and pitch. but I think Editor G is trying to solve
some of these things. Look them up first.
Okay.
I think that's all.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. No questions are coming up. I think that's all.
Okay. Hey, thanks everyone for joining. I hope it was useful. The idea was to focus on fundamentals more than anything else. And thanks, Aarti, for arranging all this.
Absolutely. It was a great session, Manish. Thank you so much for being a speaker here and accepting our invitation. Thank you so much. And thank you all the attendees here who came and joined us and asking so much questions. It was a great session, literally.
Okay. So,
yeah.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Bye. Bye now.
Yeah. Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Yeah. Yeah.